All right, welcome back to another video. Today we're going to be talking about low yield wells. So maybe you found yourself in a situation where you drilled a well and you don't have a lot of water in it, or maybe you are in an area that you're considering purchasing a house with a low yield well, or maybe you just know that the area has low yielding wells and want to know what your options are. So what we're going to do is we're going to put together a multi-part video series. I believe we're going to make this one about a total of four separate parts, just to kind of break it up rather than just film a long like 30-minute video. We're going to break this up for you guys. And first today, we're going to go over what some of the common causes of a low yielding well are. And then we're going to transition in the future videos into discussing what options you have in terms of resolving the issue or making the situation more livable. So let's jump right into it. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to talk about is soil composition. So a big factor on whether or not you're going to have decent production out of a well is soil composition. So that relates to if you have a high quantity of clay, or if you have a high quantity of material that creates like a cementy paste. Really, soil composition, and it's all over the board in terms of what is possible. But ultimately, the important thing is if you don't have really sandy soil, for example, would be relatively ideal, then you're not going to have a perfect environment for the water to pass through easily. So you may have to worry, you may have to consider things like lime scale buildup. You may have to consider things like iron bacteria. You may have to concern yourself with high amounts of like granular stone, which is going to eventually create like a cement and plug up the well. So there's a lot of different conditions that relate to soil composition that are going to tie in with the overall production of the well when it's drilled, as well as the production of the well over time. And each one of those influences the well differently. We're not going to go into each individual circumstance. Rather, we're just going to talk briefly about the soil composition and what an aquifer generally looks like, because of course, one of the biggest key ingredients to getting water from a well is having access to water in a well. So we're going to jump over here and take a look at the generic drawing I've put up of aquifer. Okay, so this is just a generic overview of what an aquifer might look like. So you've got your soil aquifer here, which is represented by the blue area. You've just got the ground level here. We've got a little well casing here going down into the first layer. So where you can run into problems is if at any point in these areas you have flow restrictions. So like I mentioned, clay is a big one that commonly can cause flow restriction. And typically, even if water is available initially, if the porosity of the soil is not going to allow the flow through, eventually this water surrounding the well can get used up, and it will take a really long time for the water in these surrounding areas to perforate through the soil and actually get into the well. So we'll get into that a little bit further with one of the other points that I wanted to talk about. But one thing that you just want to consider is soil composition has a big impact, and that's one thing that you really can't change. The earth is made of what it's made of, and in your particular area, there's not much you can do. But there are things that we can do to address the production of the well. So we'll get into that in a future video. All right, so the next thing we're going to talk about is a poorly constructed well. You want to make sure that you use a well driller who is familiar with the area. If you hear of a new company in town that drilled wells in another state, you want to make sure that they're familiar with the well types and materials used in your area, because oftentimes they're used for a reason. And we'll jump back over to the other side of the board and kind of discuss some of those things to consider. Okay, so what we've got here is just a very rudimentary well that I've drawn up, and of course these represent your water source. So one thing that I'll point out here is we've got our perforated pipe here. We've got a reduced size well casing that goes the rest of the way down. It's pretty common in areas where you've got decent production for for your well casing to reduce in size once you get down far enough. And oftentimes they transition from a steel liner to a PVC liner. And I believe that that mostly relates to the steel is going to be more resistant to the soil up here, which is going to have more force applied to it. Whereas you get deeper down and there's a lot more compaction around, so the soil is not typically going to move, so you can transition to PVC safely. But some things to consider is if you're in an area that has already really low producing flow through the soil, as we discussed in soil composition, it may not be a good idea to reduce the diameter of the well to save that money. And also you might notice that the perforations here only go up about 1/3 of the distance that we have water here. Now again, in a situation where you've got a lot of readily available water, this well is going to easily fill up to this highest point of water here. But if you're in a situation where you don't have good production, you may have opted to have slots go farther up the casing here in order to encourage more water to be available to go into the casing. So by no means am I a well drilling expert, but a few of these common sense tips can definitely save you in the long run. And oftentimes everything that I've described here is employed to try to save a person money and make the well quote more competitive, because oftentimes if you're smart, you're going to shop around and you're going to look at different prices that well drillers are going to give you, and you want to make sure that they're using comparable materials. And also a good recommendation would be to look at different well logs in your area and determine what materials that are being used, what the well production rates are, and kind of compare and contrast that data, especially if you're in an area with a known quantity of low producing wells. So you want to take every precaution ahead of time, because drilling a well is oftentimes very expensive, anywhere from $10,000 to $40,000. So doing just a little bit of research on public information and knowing what materials are going to be used, you're going to be able to estimate better what your flow is going to be, as well as know whether or not somebody's trying to win the job by using cheaper materials. Okay, so up next, we're going to talk about improper placement of the pump. Now, when you're comparing different estimates from well pump installers, you may notice that one guy's using a 3/4 horse and one guy's using a 1 horse or something along those lines. So let's talk about, again, we'll go and take a look at an example and talk about what that means. Okay, so once again, we've got a rudimentary well here. And if you couldn't tell, we've got the pump sitting right in this area here. Now, most folks would be able to recognize that you're not taking advantage of the full capacity of the well, because once the water level gets below the pump's intake, which is generally somewhere in the middle here, then you're no longer pumping any water. So a smart person, and maybe this is our 3/4 horsepower pump, and maybe down here would have been our 1 horsepower pump, and it would have been much deeper so that you would have that additional capacity in the well. So once again, saving money is not always the answer when it comes to comparing what could work and what's going to work the best for you. So improper placement or improper sizing of a pump is going to have a huge impact on the amount of available water you've got. And since we're talking about low producing wells, typically in a low producing well where a person doesn't have a reservoir or some other type of system involved, they're relying on the capacity of the water in their well to feed them water into their house. A typical 8-inch well, I believe, is about 6 gallons per foot, roughly, of water. So by getting this extra, let's say, 20 feet, we're adding, you know, quite a bit of water. You're adding another 120 gallons of water. That could easily help to supplement and allow you to take a 10-minute shower plus wash some laundry rather than take a 30-second shower. Okay, so the next thing we're going to talk about is development of scale or iron. So let's get to it. Okay, so what we've got here is basically a zoomed in version of a well casing. These are the perforations that replenish the water into the well. And this is a pretty simple concept that most often affects people over time, where initially the well is going to produce really well, no pun intended, but then over time, these areas here can start to get, okay, as I was saying before the pen so really didn't work, over time, these areas can start to get blocked off. In some cases completely, maybe that one's letting water through a little bit, but the rest of these are kind of getting blocked off, and it's going to either decrease the production. Well, typically it'll start by decreasing the production, and then it could potentially cut off the production completely from some of these areas while still having others available. So you're going to really notice this if you've already got a low producing well. But in situations where you used to have a lot of water in your well, and now all of a sudden you don't, your pump's running dry or what have you, sometimes the composition of the soil could lend itself to either iron buildup or scale buildup. You know, there's always another situation that it could occur, which is over pumping the well, but we're going to jump into that here in just a minute. All right, so the last one on the list for today is over pumping, groundwater depletion. And groundwater depletion, kind of the same thing. So let's just talk about what that is over here. Okay, so we've got this drawing here. You probably recognize these at this point. So this would be our aquifer level, this would be our ground level, and then this would just be a separating layer of soil between the two layers. And then of course we've got a well here. So what can happen is if you, let's say you've got a well that produces 10 gallons per minute, and you're constant, and maybe the low yielding well folks would love to have a well that produces 10 gallons a minute. But anyways, I digress. So you've got a, you're producing 10 gallons a minute, and let's say you just run the well, because you need more water, you just run the well constantly, day in, day out, you're running as much water as you can get out of that well. Well, the way that wells regenerate is they kind of deplete in a format similar to this. Well, it's more like a bell curve, but I'm not good at drawing that. So they deplete similar to this. So this may be your first stage of depletion, your second stage of depletion, third, fourth, what have you. And the water level gradually will drop. And if the soil in this area dries out, it can make it really hard for the water to ever go back into that particular area. So what you can end up with is either an overall drop in the water level if you do long-term pumping or over pump the well, or you can end up with what they call as groundwater depletion, where the composition of the soil changes due to the dryness and due to not having the amount of water in it, so it doesn't have as much water readily available to flow through the soil. So, and my drawing is getting a little bit messy, but what you can end up with is all of a sudden where you used to have 10 gallons a minute up here at the top, now maybe you've only got 10 gallons a minute or less way down here at this lower level, and the water is essentially just going around you at that point to flow to lower ground or what have you. And that can lead to some really severe problems, and that's where having a sufficiently sized well, sufficiently sized pump, and all of the properly selected equipment for your area is important. And it's also important to try to work the well not in an overuse situation. Well, that didn't make a lot of sense, but it's important to try to not overwork your well in order to preserve it, especially if you're in an area where the soil composition lends itself to these types of problems. Okay, so that kind of relates to what some of the conditions are that you may encounter that are a byproduct of why you have a low producing well. So what we're gonna do in the next videos is look at some different solutions, some different ways to approach low yielding wells, and then we're gonna talk about specifically what problems are gonna address, or what solutions are gonna address these individual problems, so that if you're determining maybe adding an extra bedroom to your house, building a new home on a piece of property where there's an existing low yielding well, we're going to go through all these different scenarios and kind of come up with solutions that are going to make life a little simpler with a low yielding well, make things livable again. So stay tuned. We've got more videos coming up in this series. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Hit that little notification button if you want to get notified when we come out with the next set of videos. So we'll catch you next time.